Good morning. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and thank you for coming out today. We have a great day. This is the day when nearly 2,000 years ago, the Lord Jesus Christ went to the cross, and on that cross, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And we are delighted to have the opportunity to put together this service to honor the Lord. This service is going to be broadcast live over WJSM radio, so we're going to get started a little ahead of time so that we can get caught up to the radio, or the radio gets caught up to us, whatever the case may be. But we truly are delighted to have you with us, and if you can stay the entire 3 hours, we would invite you to do that. If you have to leave, why, feel free to do that. Restrooms, if you need them, you go out this door to my right and your left and turn right, and you'll see the difference between the men and the women's restroom, and you can use those. But the Lord has given us a great team. We are really honored to have all these pastors with us, and Chiz Ryder to play the trumpet. It's just going to be a great day in the Lord, I believe. And keep in mind that these 3 hours that we're doing this between noon and 3 is probably when Jesus was really bearing our sin in his body on that cross. It was during that time he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? So this is sort of a solemn time for those of us who are Christians. And so I want to encourage you to just have a good afternoon as we focus on the Lord. Let's take our hymn book and turn to number 111. Number 111. And we will sing all the verses of this song. Are we pretty close time? How much time do we have before we go on? Oh, getting the tie line set up. Well, good thing they didn't have tie lines in the name of, in the day of Christ on the cross. Huh? So. Anyway, let's go ahead and take our hymn books and turn to number 111 and stand as we sing all the verses of Lead Me to Calvary. Welcome to the annual Good Friday service coming to you from the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania. We are going to be here for the next 3 hours to focus on the theme, the glory of the cross of Jesus Christ. Messages will be delivered by the following pastors. Pastor Tom Butler will speak on the people of the cross. Pastor Barry Yingling will speak on the purpose of the cross. Pastor Mark Mahan will speak on the power of the cross. Pastor Gary Dull will speak on the prospect of the cross. Our special music throughout the afternoon will be provided by trumpeter Chiz Ryder. If you are in the Altoona area, please feel free to drop in and join us until 3 o'clock this afternoon. The Faith Baptist Church is located at 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city. Now, let's join those who are gathered in the Faith Baptist Sanctuary and sing along with them, Lead Me to Calvary.
Yeah. You're a good singer.
We want to welcome those of you who are joining us by radio to the Good Friday service coming to you from the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania, the United States of America. And if you are anywhere in the Altoona area, we will be here until about 3 o'clock as we focus on the glory of the cross. We've got a great service put together that the Lord has led us to develop. Different pastors throughout the course of the afternoon will be speaking, and you won't want to miss it. But if you are in the Altoona area, anywhere, we would invite you to come and join in with us. And those of you who are joining us by way of the World Wide Web and YouTube and Facebook Live, whatever the case, we're delighted to have you with us as well. And we are going to honor the Lord here. It is our desire throughout this period of time to focus on Christ and who He is and what He's done for us on the cross. And we keep in mind that if we were to turn the pages back in history, as it were, that it was between 9 in the morning and 3 in the afternoon that Jesus Christ was on the cross. But between 12 noon and 3 o'clock, it was darkened all over the face of the earth, when we believe that's the time when the Lord Jesus Christ was bearing our sin in a great way, as that period of time was beginning when He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? So that's why we have this service between 12 noon and 3, and let's just focus on the Lord today and worship Him in spirit and in truth. We want to begin by asking you to turn to your copy of God's Word to John chapter 19. John chapter 19, and just to lay the foundation for the study, we want to read verses 14 through 18. John chapter 19, verses 14 through 18, and I invite you to stand as out of respect for God's Word as I read and you follow along. John chapter 19, verses 14 through 18, where the Word of God says, "And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour. And He saith unto the Jews, Behold your king. But they cried out, Away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto them, Shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, We have no king but Caesar. Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of the skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two other with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst." May God bless the reading of His Word to our hearts. We know indeed that He will do that. Pastor Chaz is going to come and lead us in prayer.
Dearly Father, the only thing I can think of to say today is thank you. Thank you for the love that you had for us in sending your Son to die on the cross for us. Lord, as we think back to Isaiah 53, and we realize that it says, He was wounded for our transgressions, He was bruised for our iniquities. And then later on, and the Lord hath laid on Him the iniquity of us all. I thank you that you have offered us the free gift of the forgiveness of sins. Lord, as we think about this day and what we are celebrating, we thank you for the freedom that you give us to overcome this sin, and that it's all by your power. And all we have to do is have faith in the finished work of Christ on the cross for us. Thank you for that, Lord. And thank you for how you continue to work in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Remain standing as we take our hymn books and turn to number 112, the Old Rugged Cross, number 112. And we will sing all verses of this particular song, number 112.
Oh,
are delighted to have with us throughout the course of the afternoon Brother Chiz Ryder to play for us on the trumpet, and we are delighted that he can be with us today. Welcome to Faith Baptist Church Good Friday service. Brother Chiz, it's all yours.
Thank you.
It is well with my soul. And it's interesting to note that when the world is all going through turmoil and trouble, through faith in Jesus Christ, we can say, it is well with my soul. And now to speak to us about the people of the cross, we have Pastor Tom Butler from the Reservoir Bible Church in Hollidaysburg. Pastor Tom, come and share, please.
Thank you. Boy, if I could have background music when I preach like Chiz, I'd be even better, wouldn't I? Okay. A couple of things. This outline that I have today, if you would like a copy of it, I put some in the back for you there. Let us stand together. I'm going to read some scripture. I was going to read a whole lot, but I think I'll move this down a little bit. A whole lot of scripture, but I'll shorten it a little bit. And verse 38 of Luke 23. Luke 23, 38. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, and saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost thou not fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justify, for we are justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Let's pray. Father, we ask your blessing upon this simple message today, and that it may touch your heart through the Spirit of God. In Jesus' name, amen. There was a young boy who went up to his pastor after the service and at the back of the church, and he saw a plaque. And he asked the pastor, what are all these names on this plaque? And the pastor said, these are the names of people who've died in the service of the Lord here. And the young man looked at him and said, did they die in the 10 o'clock service or the 11 o'clock service? Okay, so if I can get through this message and nobody dies, I'm successful. Let's, you know, amen. I'm getting there. Okay, and so we just have to say that it's amazing. Also, this message is being recorded for your protection. So I've got some outlines in the back. But first of all, my first point, since I have 20 minutes, I have to get going here. The wicked people who crucified Jesus. So the people at the cross, some were there to watch, some were there because they loved Jesus, and some were there because of the wickedness of their heart. And the first group were the Pharisees and the religious leaders who planned to crucify Jesus. They planned the whole thing. It was not an accident. It was a mock trial in the middle of the night, and they crucified him through a series of events that they had planned beforehand. Also, there were scoffers and mockers and people who laughed at him, and those who had rejected him and even were false witnesses against him. They were there watching the events on the cross. The wicked soldiers who delighted in the crucifixion and going through the crown of thorns on his head and driving the nails. It was their job, but they did it very well. I've been told and read that when they crucify someone on the cross in the days of the Roman Empire, that people would stay on the cross for sometimes days and just barely breathing just a little bit. And sometimes the fowls of the air would come and pick their flesh apart right while they were still alive. It was a horrible way to die. But our Lord Jesus was taken down from the cross. They pierced his side and the blood ran out. And he cried out, it is finished, and he gave up the ghost. He died. Because he had to be taken off the cross because it was a holy day. So he wasn't left on the cross for days, and we can be thankful for that. Also, they placed a crown of thorns on his head. The wicked people did. Mocking that he was the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, when he really was. See, we look at that and we say, how could they do such a thing? But our society we live in now is doing the very same thing. At a convention a couple of years ago, if you remember, at the end of the convention, they shouted, "No God, no God." You remember that? That's where our world is coming to. And so at the foot of the cross, there were these wicked ones who were saying, "No, you're not going to be our God. No, you're not going to be our king. You're not going to lead us. You're not who we want." And they rejected him. Now this group, one, they're going to go to hell. Let's just put it straightly. They're going to go to hell because they rejected Christ. If you turn with me to John 8, if you turn with me to John 8, 44. "Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father will ye do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." So Jesus had already said to these evil people, "You belong to your father the devil." So as a minister, I have to agree with the Lord. They're evil people. They're going to go to hell. And they chose to. It wasn't something they had to do, but they chose to do. Jesus said, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." Even as wicked as they were, the love of God reached out. And even those that wicked ones that watched him on the cross still had a chance to break down and accept the Lord. Secondly, the lost people who watched Jesus. You know, there's a lot of people that came to the cross. If you remember, people sometimes show up just for the show. You know, they're just there to enjoy the process and watching everything. I remember as a little boy, I loved Westerns, you know. And as a boy, I went every Saturday morning to the Western movie for 10 cents. And I loved it. But I always noticed something. Whenever there was a hanging, all the people of the town showed up to watch it. Yeah. You know? And I'm sure there were people at the cross who were there watching the events go on. Also, during the French Revolution, people brought lunches and they beheaded people for months. I mean, it went on for months. And there were thousands that gathered just to watch the beheading, see? Because there's something wrong inside of people unless they know the Lord Jesus Christ, that sometimes they have that evil side. But this group of people, I classified them as a group of people who were just there. They were not committed to the right. They weren't committed to the left. They were just there to see what happened. Maybe they didn't know what was going on. Maybe they didn't even know who was being crucified. They might have heard of Jesus. They might have got a rumor of what's going on, but see, the whole trial was happening in the middle of the night. So there wasn't a whole lot of time to put out flyers about the crucifixion. They were there to see what went on. They were uncommitted, and they maybe didn't know what to believe. And they didn't realize that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who made them, was hanging on that cross. Now this group, I think many of us in this group maybe have been saved on the day of Pentecost, you know, when Peter preached and 3,000 souls. See, I'm wondering if some of these people came to know the Lord after witnessing the crucifixion and then Pentecost, that these people were people who realized their mistake and accepted the Lord Jesus as their Savior. And also, maybe through the preaching of the gospel, they later came to Christ, because this is an undecided group. And so maybe later in their lives, they made a decision for the Lord Jesus Christ. You were once an undecided person. You were once a person who didn't know what to believe. What religion, what person do you want to believe in? And then one day you gave your heart to Christ, and it was settled. Now Jesus said another word on the cross. He said, I thirst. And to me, when I see those words, it speaks to me. I almost preached a message on Jesus, what he said to me on the cross, personally. But he said, I thirst. And you know, our Savior was there with his mouth cleaving, his tongue cleaving to his mouth, and was in such agony for thirst, and yet he gave us the water of life. He gave us the living water. He was there suffering and dying of thirst, and yet here's the man that talked to the woman at the well and said, the water I give you will spring up into your life for eternity. So he died, our Lord, and he died partly of thirst, and yet he poured out the water like when Moses struck the rock. He was struck, but boy, we got the water. The water of life, the water of eternal life that saves us eternally. So I'm hoping, looking back, that some of these people actually receive the Lord later in their life. And then there's the third one. The victorious people who loved Jesus, they were at the cross, just like you are here today. You're here today not because I'm preaching. You're here today because you love Jesus. You love the Lord. You want to remember what he did for you on the cross. There was a thief on the cross who cried out to Jesus for salvation. He knew he was lost. I preached a sermon a few years ago in my church. I am the thief on the cross. I've broken every commandment. I deserve to be there. I cannot save myself. Time's running out. And yet, at the last moment, I turned to Jesus and said, come into my heart and save me. And he did. So this thief on the cross was there. We think about the people standing around the cross, but there was a thief on the cross that very night would be with Jesus in paradise. The mother, Mary Magdalene, and John were there. Can you imagine watching your son being crucified? Can you imagine Mary Magdalene, after what Christ had done for her, and the disciple whom Jesus loved, watching their Savior on the cross being crucified? It must have been heartbreaking for them to see that. How about Nicodemus? Wow. The righteous, justified, born again Pharisee. Amen. Nicodemus came to Jesus by night, hungry for something. Hungry to know, because he knew, and the Pharisees knew, that no man can do these things Jesus did unless it be of God. So that's the beginning. That's when the Holy Spirit pricked his heart. And he came to Jesus by night, and later in life he received Jesus as his Savior, and he stood up for Jesus, and he was there. Isn't it amazing that even high-ranking religious people can get born again? I think that's amazing, you know? You know, maybe some people will get born again in our country, in our some of our leaders. Amen? The other believers who loved Jesus and came to the cross. How about the Roman soldier who cried out, surely, this is the Son of God. Now, I don't have time here, but I believe that Roman soldier believed in the Lord Jesus Christ when he said that. Because Jesus said to Peter, who do you say I am? And he said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. My Father in heaven revealed it to you. So the Father in heaven revealed to this soldier that Jesus was indeed the Son of God. So I believe that Roman soldier who cried out will be a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. And as he said to that thief on the cross, today thou wilt be with me in paradise, all those that stood at the cross, the people who stood at the cross, who loved Jesus and trusted Jesus, will one day be with him in heaven. Because once Jesus was crucified, and Galatians said, I am crucified with Christ, So we were crucified with him in his death, burial, and resurrection, and we will be with Christ forevermore. Amen?
Amen.
This is not just a sad day. This is a happy day that we can be with the Lord. And all this group will spend eternity in heaven with God. The first group, their father's the devil. The second group may get saved on Pentecost or may have gotten saved during the gospel message, but the third group will be with Christ in heaven forever and ever. But there's one person missing as I finish this message. And as I thought about it, and I have a mind that like goes wild sometimes, but I thought about Barabbas. I thought about, where was he on this day? You ever thought about that? Did he decide, you know, I'm going to go up and check out this thing that they set me free for, this guy? He didn't do anything. Maybe I'll go to the cross and see what's going on. Maybe he believed later. I don't know, but I think about that one who was set free from all his evil deeds, and his judgment was placed upon Jesus, just like you and I. And when he wandered away, did it affect his life? If you're not saved here this morning, if you're not born again this morning, you know that you're like a Barabbas. You're guilty of sin. You have no hope but Jesus Christ. And though you might be set free from some judgment in your life, if you don't have Jesus, you don't have eternal life. So I thought about, well, maybe Barabbas was there. And as I close, shortly after the Russian Revolution, a Kremlin leader was sent to an anti-God rally, okay? And for 1 hour, he stood up and he railed and railed and railed about God, cursing Jesus, cursing the Bible, doing everything he could. And this was a tremendous rally. And after he got done spewing all that evil for the Bible and for Christ, there was a minister there, and he stood up and said, "Can I have a word?" And the minister was allowed to go up to the microphone and say a word. And all he said was, "He is risen." And all the people stood up and they shouted back, "He is risen indeed." You cannot take God out of this world. You cannot take the Bible out of this world. You can't take salvation out of our hearts once Christ has put it through. Amen. Our gracious Father, Lord, we know that you love us with an everlasting love. And as a man who had a dream, and he dreamed that he saw the Roman soldiers lashing at your back with a cat of nine tails, he reached out and grabbed that soldier's arm. But when the soldier turned around and looked at him, he was amazed, Lord, because he saw his own face on the soldier. Listen, we put you on the cross. We crucified you. And we can't stop. We couldn't stop it, because if we did, we wouldn't be saved today. I thank you, Lord, for loving us and dying for us on the cross and giving us eternal life. And I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pastor Butler, for that beautiful message on the cross. Have you surveyed the wondrous cross? Jesus gave his all on that cross. What are we giving whenever we survey the cross? 117 in our hymn books is a song that talks about the cross. Let's stand and sing all four verses of "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
Glory God.
Chiz Ryder. Wish I could breathe as easy as he does, let alone play the trumpet. But what a blessing. Again, if you are just joining in on the radio, why, this is the live Good Friday service coming to you from the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania. And we are focusing on the glory of the cross, because you see, it was nearly 2,000 years ago that Jesus Christ was on that cross from 9 in the morning until 3 o'clock in the afternoon, bearing your sin and my sin. Thank the Lord that we didn't have to bear it, because that would have meant eternal separation from God in hell. But through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross and through our belief in him, we can have eternal life with God in heaven, in a land without tears, and in a time without end. And we trust today on this Good Friday, as we look forward to Resurrection Sunday, that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, that you will call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. Because remember, historically, on Friday, Jesus died. But on Sunday, he rose again. Jesus Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. As we continue to focus on the glory of the cross, we're going to invite Pastor Barry Yingling from the Woodcock Valley Bible Church to come and share with us from the Word of God. Pastor Barry, God bless.
Thank you, Pastor Dahl. You know, if the Lord tarries in his return another 100 years, I have a pretty good idea who might be blowing that final trumpet. Do a good job, brother. Thank you. All right, if you would stand with me and turn with you in your Bibles, your copy of God's Word, to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to read a few verses out of 1 Peter chapter 2 as we begin this section of looking at the purpose of the cross. 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning in verse 21. The Word of God says this: "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered us, leaving us an example, that ye should follow his footsteps." Just follow his steps. "Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls." Let's pray. Gracious God and Father, Lord, as we continue in this service, honoring what you did for us some 2,000 years ago upon the cross of Calvary through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father God, I just pray that you continue blessing our time. We thank you so much for what you've done so far, meeting with us here. And we just pray, Lord, that would continue. That again, Lord, now as we look at the purpose of the cross, that, Lord, your Spirit would speak to our hearts. Father, I pray you just speak through me. May the words I say and share be your words. Lord, may you just, again, open up to us some things that maybe we've read before, we've heard before, but I pray it be new today, that we would see it with new eyes and truly maybe have a greater understanding of really what took place and all that you've done. Not so that we can just say we have more knowledge, but Lord, so that we can grow in our relationship with you, so that we can live out that relationship to the world around us. So Lord God, we just place this time into your hands, looking forward to seeing what you'll do. In Christ's most precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much. You may be seated. As we have the opportunity this afternoon to look at the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, I'm getting very thankful for just the privilege to be able to be a part of this service. You know, I don't know how many other of these kind of services are going on right now, but there's a lot of churches that don't do anything on Friday. That's sad. That's one of the, you know, when we think of these next few days in the life of a believer, these are the most important, the most crucial. Because without today, without that Friday, and without Sunday, we have no hope. We have nothing to look forward to. And so I believe it's critical for Christians to really set aside today and this whole weekend, focusing on what Christ has done for us. But right now in this time, we're going to ask a question. What was the purpose of the cross? Pastor Butler looked at the people of the cross, and I've been tasked with tackling the question about the purpose of the cross. And there's a couple things, a question or two we want to ask first, some points that we want to consider when we consider the idea of what was the purpose of the cross. And the first thing I want to look at is the purpose the Romans had in the cross. What did the Romans have behind the cross? Why did they use it? The Romans were the ones that were in control of the known world at the time. And during that time, you know, crucifixion was one of the means that they would use to execute people. Now, maybe there's some folks today that thought that was the only means by which they executed people, but it wasn't. It was one of the many forms that they had. So let's ask the question, why did the Romans use the cross? Well, the Romans had a belief. They believed that the punishment should fit the crime. So depending on the different crimes that were committed, there were different means of punishments that they had, even when it came to execution. They would sometimes, a form of capital punishment would be stoning like the Jews did. Sometimes it would be hanging. Sometimes it would be, there was one called the sack. I'm not going to go into details about that. That was another means that they would execute people. One, they had a place in Rome where there was this rock, this cliff, and sometimes they would use that to execute people. But why the cross? If they had all these other means of execution, what was the cross for? What was crucifixion for in the Roman case? Well, again, as I had shared, the Romans were in charge of the known world at that time. They had many nations and people under their authority, and they wanted to make sure that those peoples and nations stayed under their authority. And so one of the means that they chose for punishing people was this thing known as the cross, because if somebody, for instance, committed treason or was rebelling against the government, the cross was one of the main ways that they would execute those kind of people. See, the Romans needed a form of punishment that would deter people from doing the same crime over and over again. And the cross was the perfect means by doing so. Brother Butler shared a little bit about some of the things that Jesus went through on the cross. And you think about that. You know, we have a beautiful cross behind us. But when you go back to 2,000 years ago, the cross didn't look so pretty. See, the Romans, because of the purpose of that cross, they wanted to put people on a cross that was, crucify them in a way that was very excruciating, very painful, but also very slow. They didn't want people to die quickly. They wanted them to suffer through everything that they were facing. And they also wanted it to be very public. Typically, the crosses were placed along roadsides where everybody could see them. And the other thing was, sometimes we think of crosses like being really high, but when you read the passages of Scripture, for instance, when Jesus received that vinegar to drink, it was from a reed, at most, which was 4 feet long. Cross couldn't have been real high. That was on purpose. They were meant to be low. The victims were stripped, beaten, and their crime was placed somewhere upon that cross so everybody could see it. But why? Because the Romans wanted everybody, if they looked at that criminal, to know why they were there, and they wanted them to see for an extended period of time what they were going through, what the punishment was if you committed the same crime. It was agonizing. It was humiliating. Romans knew that. So that's why they used it, particularly in instances of rebellion and treason. Now, sometimes other folks were placed on the cross as well. But from the Roman perspective, the purpose of the cross was one to deter further crimes. And so it had to be extraordinary. It had to go to great lengths to make sure it stuck in the mind of the people so that they wouldn't follow in the footsteps of the one that was on the cross. But I got an interesting question. When we look at the biblical account, we know it was by the hands of the Romans Jesus was crucified. But let me ask you, who asked for Jesus to be crucified? The Jews. Remember, when Pilate's bringing Jesus before the Jews, he was going to set somebody free. They called to set Barabbas free. And then he said, well, what do you want me to do with Jesus? They said, crucify him. They didn't ask for any other means. They wanted crucifixion. Well, I believe the reason they called for it is because God had a purpose in the cross. God had a purpose for the cross. So the Romans used it for one means. That just served God's purpose for the cross. You know, when we look at the timing of when Christ came and everything that took place in His life, you go through history, and it was the perfect time. Because everything that needed to happen in the life of Christ, including His death, that was the perfect time for Him to come so that everything could be fulfilled for His life here on this earth. The cross is part of that. Now, I could give a simple answer for the purpose of the cross, that it was done just to fulfill prophecy, because we go in the Old Testament and we look at things concerning the Messiah. We could see that He was supposed to die in a certain way. We could go through that, but I don't like to just take a simple answer. Now, granted, I don't have a ton of time, so I've got to be careful here. But I want to ask the question. You know, God, before the foundation of the world, had already planned this all out. He already knew Jesus Christ was going to go to the cross of Calvary. He knew He was going to die. He knew the means. He knew the method. He knew everything about it before this world was even formed. So my question is, why did God choose the cross? Because there's other means of sacrifice. Say, if it was just so Jesus could be the sacrifice for our sins, well, why didn't God use another way? Why the cross? I mean, for instance, go back to Abraham. When Abraham was going to offer up his son Isaac as a sacrifice unto God, how did he do it? He didn't hang him on a cross, did he? No, he bound him up, he made an altar, laid his son upon that altar, and he was going to kill him with a knife. Well, why didn't God the Father plan the same thing for Jesus? Why the cross? Well, I believe there's at least three reasons. Three reasons why it had to be a cross that Jesus had to die upon. First one, if you will, turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, if you were in 1 Peter, keep your finger there because we will come back. But go with me to Hebrews chapter 9. Chapter 9, we'll do this very quickly. Verse 22. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22. The first reason I believe Jesus had to die on the cross is because one of the things that Jesus had to do as a sacrifice for our sins is to shed His blood. To shed His blood. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22. The Word of God says this, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. And without," what's the next phrase say? "Shedding of blood is no remission." Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, no forgiveness for sins. Jesus Christ's blood had to be shed. How do we know that? Well, you go all the way back to Genesis. When Adam and Eve sinned, what had to happen to atone for their sins? An animal had to be sacrificed, its blood shed, and that laid the pattern, the foundation from which all sacrifices would follow for the forgiveness of sins. Blood had to be shed. God required the payment for that sin was the shedding of blood. People can die in numerous different ways without ever shedding blood. You can drown. Don't shed blood that way. They can hang you. You don't really shed blood that way either. Many ways that you could die without ever shedding a drop of blood. So if Jesus had to shed His blood, that eliminates all those. But it wasn't just shedding one or two or three drops of blood. Because again, what was the pattern? It's the sacrifice of these animals. And when you go back and you look at the Jewish sacrifices, they didn't just nick the animal, just take a little couple drops and they were good. It required a lot of blood. So Jesus had to die by a means that would shed not just a few drops of His blood, shed all of it. And when you look at what took place on the cross, it was a perfect means by which someone could shed their blood. Not only were they beaten before they went there, but even just hanging there, after enduring all that they went through, Jesus shed His blood for our sins upon the cross of Calvary. Second thing that had to be done, back to 1 Peter chapter 2. We read it in verse 24. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Not only did He have to shed His blood to give us forgiveness of sins, to be that sacrifice, He had to bear the weight of our sins. He had to bear the weight of our sins. Who His own self bear our sins in His own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. The reason we have this service 12 12 and 3, because we believe during this time, Jesus was bearing the weight of all of our sins. All of our sins upon His body. Because the Word of God says that He did that He had to do that, that our sins had to be placed upon Him, just like the Jews when they offered up that sacrifice on behalf of their sins. They placed their hand upon the head of that sacrifice, signifying that their sins were being placed upon this before it was killed. Jesus Christ had to have our sins placed upon His body. There's many ways to die that are very quick. Very quick. But if Jesus died quickly, He wouldn't have had time to bear the weight of your sins and mine. He needed a death that was prolonged, long enough so that He could face the judgment for your sins and mine while He hung on that cross. When you go back and look at the means by which the Romans killed people, there was really only one. It took a long period of time for the execution to take place. That was the cross. Jesus had to go to the cross of Calvary because He had to shed His blood. He had to bear the weight of our sins because it was the only means that could allow both those to take place in the way that it did. But that's not the only thing. That's not the only reason. Turn with me, if you will, to John chapter 3. John chapter 3. Jesus says He's talking to Nicodemus, a scholar concerning the things of God. But Nicodemus didn't know as much as maybe he thought he did. That's why he came to Jesus. And it's very interesting. In this conversation Nicodemus has with Jesus, and Jesus talking to him about heaven, answering that question, how is it that I can have eternity in heaven? Jesus tells him he must be born again. You must be born again to be saved. Nicodemus is questioning, I don't understand that. And of all the examples Jesus could have gave from the Old Testament that Nicodemus would have known well, he chose one. One example. John chapter 3, verse 14. Jesus says this, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And that word must means it needs to happen. It has to happen. That whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. See, the third reason that it had to be on the cross was because Jesus had to die in a way that He was lifted up for all to see. He had to be lifted up so that people could look to Him and be saved. When you think about the crucifixion, it was a very visible thing on purpose. Romans wanted people to see what was happening. Anybody could have looked and saw what was taking place to Jesus on that cross. That's what we looked at just a little bit ago with Pastor Butler. The people of the cross. Those people looking at the events that were taking place in front of them. It was very visible. And even today, the cross is very visible. We've got the image behind us. You see it in so many different places. People today can still look to the cross and see Jesus Christ. Jesus had to be lifted up. So we think about that, and we think about the means of sacrifice. There was only one that was suitable to meet all these three things. Amen. That Jesus could shed His blood, bear the weight of our sins, and be lifted up so all could see and be saved. You ask, what is the purpose of the cross? I believe the purpose of the cross was to allow Jesus to give Himself as the perfect sacrifice for our sins. It was the perfect means for that sacrifice to be made. That was the purpose of the cross. There's only one way for us to be saved, and that's through Jesus Christ and the work that He did on that cross of Calvary. I remember a preacher once told me, somebody said, why does there only have to be one way? I loved his answer. Because God in His sovereignty and His knowledge didn't need to come up with a bunch of different ways. He only needed one perfect way. And that perfect way involved the cross of Calvary. Let's pray. Gracious God and Father, again, Lord, thank You so much. Because I am so thankful, again, for who You are. I'm thankful that in eternity past, You looked forward. And You saw our tremendous need because of our sin. And You had a plan. You had a plan in place that would bring Your Son into this world at just the perfect moment. And then he would live his life sinlessly on this earth, but then willingly offer himself up as a sacrifice. And he didn't die in just any way. He died in the only way that can make that sacrifice more than sufficient to take away our sins. For whosoever calls upon him shall be saved. Father God, I thank you so much for that cross of Calvary. And I just pray this morning, if there's anybody here who's never come to the foot of that cross, today would be the day that they'd see their need and trust in him. Because through him, they can have life eternal. Thank you, Lord. We pray this all in Christ, the most precious name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Barry Engling. If you're joining us by radio, again, I want to remind you that this is the Good Friday service coming to you from the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania. If you happen to be listening around the world, we are, of course, in the United States of America. And we thank you so very, very much for the pleasure of your company as we are focusing on the glory of the cross. And we believe, as the Word of God teaches, that it was from 12 o'clock noon until 3 o'clock in the afternoon that there was darkness all over the face of the earth when Jesus bore the weight of our sin. Of course, he was on the cross the whole way from 9 o'clock in the morning until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And the Bible records that he gave 7 sayings from the cross. He may have said other things. We don't know. We don't. The Bible teaches us back in the book of Isaiah that he was led as a sheep quietly to the slaughter. But we do know at least these 7 things that the Lord Jesus shared or spoke from the cross, which I just want to read to you right now to put you in the setting as to what was taking place on the cross. In John chapter 19, verses 26 and 27, Jesus said unto his mother, "Woman, behold thy son." Then saith he to the disciples, "Behold thy mother." After that, the Word of God says that one of the malefactors railed on him, saying, "If thou be Christ, save thyself and us." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And Jesus said unto him in Luke chapter 23 and verse 43, "Today shalt thou be with me in paradise." The soldiers also mocked him, saying, "If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself." The chief priests, mocking him, said, "He saved others. Himself he cannot save." They that passed by reviled him, saying, "If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross." The soldiers parted his garments, casting lots upon them. And Jesus, out of an act of mercy and love and grace, said, "Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Luke chapter 23 and verse 34. And it was the third hour, and they crucified him. And when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. That's in the period of time that we are gathered here this afternoon, between the Jewish sixth hour and the ninth hour, 12 noon and 3 o'clock in the afternoon. In Matthew chapter 27 and verse 46, Jesus cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Think about that. I had the opportunity of speaking at the Altoona Rescue Mission this morning, and we spoke on all 7 sayings of Jesus Christ from the cross, which is the first sermon I ever preached publicly, July the 18th, 1964. But as I was at the mission this morning talking about the work of Christ on the cross, I shared with the men that, as has already been emphasized by Pastor Butler and Pastor Engling, that the Romans crucified many, many people. It wasn't the physical suffering that Jesus went through that made it so bad. Some of us remember a number of years ago that film entitled The Passion of the Christ. And some of you may remember that we rented a theater and invited the community to come in and watch that film. And we praised the Lord, there were some decisions for Christ. But it wasn't the physical suffering that Jesus went through that was the issue. We also realize that there was the spiritual suffering that he went through when he bore all the sin of the world. Think about that. You and I know sometimes how we feel if we commit one sin. But Jesus bore all the sin of all the world, and the people who have ever lived, do live, or shall ever live. All sin was taken care of on the cross. That brought great agony and penalty as Jesus bore the penalty of our sin. He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. But I kind of think that the greatest of all agony was when there was that division between the Father and the Son. They had been united for eternity past. When Jesus was there in the Garden of Eden, or Garden of Gethsemane, he was in the Garden of Eden, but when he was there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he prayed, Father, if this cup can be removed from my hand, let it be done. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Jesus wasn't asking the Father to take him away from the cross. That was a settled matter before the foundation of the earth. I kind of believe that what Jesus was anticipating there was the fact that he was going to be separated from his Father. The physical anguish was terrible. The spiritual anguish in bearing our sin was awful. But for Jesus to be separated from his Father was unthinkable. And he went through all of that for you and me. And he cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Then the fifth word that the Lord Jesus spoke from the cross, as found in John 19:28, was, I thirst. As Pastor Barry emphasized, they gave him a drink of vinegar and gall. That wasn't a good drink. Even in that, he suffered. John chapter 19 and verse 30, Jesus said, it is finished. In a few minutes, I'll get to preach on that, so I'm not going to say much about that now. But the work of redemption was accomplished. And finally, Jesus said in Luke 23 and verse 46, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Listen. All of the Roman soldiers that they had, all of the armies of the world, could not have taken Jesus' life. When he was ready to give it, he said, it is finished, and into thy hands I commend my spirit. And he did that. He died for you and for me. We're approaching the halfway mark through our service here this afternoon. The question that I want to ask you is, have you been to the cross in the sense of, have you trusted Jesus Christ as Savior? Can you find a time when you've recognized that you were a sinner and called upon the name of the Lord Jesus and ask him to save you? If not, I would encourage you to do that right now. Why right now? You could die before this service is over, before you had the opportunity to talk to somebody. And if you die without Christ, it's eternal hell. But if you receive Jesus Christ as Savior, it's eternal heaven. And the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, which means to be delivered from sin, its power and its penalty and its presence through faith in Jesus Christ alone. But it's all possible because of the cross. Not that wooden implement. As Pastor Barry said, we have a couple of pretty crosses looking here, but that was an old rugged cross filled with splinters, heavy, ugly. And that was the cross on which Jesus died. And when we talk about the cross, we're not talking about that piece of wood, but we're talking about what Jesus did on that cross, shedding his blood for us. We're going to sing hymn number 121, all the verses of At the Cross. Let's sing it rejoicingly, but if you've never yet trusted Christ as Savior, I encourage you to do that. And then we're going to hear some good trumpet music after that, once again by Chiz Rider. Let's stand as we sing number 121.
Thank you.
down the Via Della Rosa, the way of the cross. Our next point of emphasis is going to be on the power of the cross, and that message will be delivered by Pastor Mark Mahon of the Community Baptist Church, but he is somebody who's going to give a testimony at this time. So, Pastor Mark, come and introduce her to us, if you would, please, and then deliver the Word of God to our hearts. God bless you.
Thank you, preacher. Thank you. Thank you, brother. You understand when we talk about the cross that it was, for the largest part, ladies who were there around the cross when our Lord was dying. Those that had ministered to him out of their substance from Galilee. Now, it seems that God's good book records for us that the disciples had forsaken him and fled. So much for manhood. But there in the darkest time stood brightly women. Women that loved him till his dying breath. That's the power of the cross, my friend. Do not believe this morning, this afternoon, do not believe this day, these loud, insistent voices that say that Christianity oppresses women. My friend, my Lord in this book has done more to exalt women than any other thing in the history of mankind itself. Behold the power of the cross. I know personally the power of the cross in my heart this morning. And so does this lady who I will introduce to you this morning or this day. I came here in the morning, got cheese and crackers in me, and now I don't know what time it is. I know this day the power of the cross in my own heart and soul. I'm also certain that on that early Sunday morning, it was certain women who were at the empty tomb, at the grave. Most unlikely and according to society, unqualified witnesses. You feel unqualified this morning. Aren't you glad this day that God uses people to do his greatest work who are often the most unqualified? Amen. It's the power of the cross, my friend. Ms. Castile is a member of the Dry Run Independent Baptist Church. She has a tremendous testimony that I trust will be a blessing to you. Ms. Castile, come, tell us your testimony and the power of the cross. Joe, Misty.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Wow, this is such an honor and a privilege, and I'm very humbled for this. Little background, my name is Misty. 51, mother of two, grandmother of four. I was an atheist once. I never grew up in a church. I can actually say at one time I would renounce God. I renounced God with every fiber of my being. I was actually a Mormon. Did baptisms for the dead, was involved in a cult, stood up here at a pulpit like this, preaching to men and women at the age of 14, a false religion, which I believed was true. I was a former drug addict, drug dealer, a former inmate of Blair County Prison. In 2008, I went from using prescription drugs legally to abusing them. 2010, I was introduced by a gentleman, well, can't say gentleman, a man, who introduced me to the needle. My world spiraled out of control after that. I went from doing prescription drugs to hardcore drugs. I'm not gonna go into detail, it's just, don't want to glorify the sin that I did. This lifestyle went on for about 4 years. Many times I should have died, didn't die, didn't even overdose. And to this day, I know why now, but then I didn't. And I praise God for that. Then in June 2014, I was arrested for the very first time ever in my life. Never been in trouble with the law. I stayed in Blair County Prison for 6 days. 2 days later, well, guess what? I was right back in there. And it was because of the person I was hanging with, and yeah, well, needless to say, I didn't learn the first time. I spent 26 days in there that time. During that time, I started first just getting out of my jail cell by going to Bible studies, you know, anything that got me out off the block and whatever. And at that time, I didn't know that what God was doing was preparing my heart to accept Him as the Savior. I still at that time did not believe. Well, toward the end of that stay, I actually started pondering about God and Christ. Well, once released, I went right back into the kind of stuff that I did, you know, even worse and even harder than before. I would mix worse drugs, more deadlier drugs. And it was so bad that my drug dealer even stopped selling to me. I mean, that's pretty bad. Then, around the first week of September 2014, I remember sitting on a bed where I was hiding, totally afraid. I was hiding, and I was afraid like never before. I began to pray and ask God, if you are real, will you help me get out of this mess I'm in, because I can't do it. Well, it wasn't but maybe 2 days later I was arrested for the third and final time. And I'm going to read a scripture, Psalms 41b. And He inclined unto me and heard my cry. Amen. And I praise God for that. Amen. Well, this time God kept me in Blair County for 4 months. Now, during that time, I was sincerely went to chapel, did Bible studies. And then on September the 8th, 2014, while in a Reformers Unanimous meeting, I asked Christ into my heart.
Amen.
And He became my Savior, and almost instantly I felt the weight of the world being lifted off of me.
Yeah.
Psalms 40, verse 2, He brought me up also out of the miry pit, horrible pit, and out of the miry clay, and established my goings.
Amen.
And I thank God for that.
Yeah.
I was released in January 2015. There I was released and I stayed in the emergency family shelter for about 2 months. And now that was by the grace of God, because that gave me time to stay away from all those who had not been arrested or had not died. I began faithfully going to RU, which is Reformers Unanimous, and attending Dry Run Church. And I praise God, the only reason I was able to stay into that facility was because none of my charges ever once was a felony. Technically, they should have been, but God was gracious not to. I moved out of the shelter and moved in with, I thought was a friend. Well, she got us evicted. Did I worry? No, because I knew God had placed me there, and I knew God was in control. He had provided me that place, and He knew my needs, and I knew that there was something better for me. Well, I paid one night for a hotel, and then my church, praise God, gave me put me in a hotel for another week. Well, then I had a friend who wasn't able to stay in his apartment for a while, so I was able to stay there. And then God blessed me with the fact that I found a housing program that accepted people with criminal histories. And even though I didn't have a felony, you know, it was still difficult to find any kind of housing assistance. And then I think of this verse, Psalms 55:22, cast thy burdens upon the Lord, and He shall sustain thee. And He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. You know, and I just praise God, and I thank God for that. And, you know, while I'm in my apartment now, which is, I really believe that God has got a sense of humor, because where I live is right across the hall from where I was last arrested at. So I have a daily reminder of where He's brought me from to where I'm at now, you know, and I just thank God for that. I should be comfortable standing in a pulpit, but I'm not, because my very first testimony was in Rockford, Illinois, at my very first Reformers Unanimous conference. I was in front of 1,000 people. 10 minutes before the conference started, I was asked to give my testimony.
Wow.
You want to talk about trial under fire? Let me tell you, I was. I've been a member now of Dry Run Independent Baptist Church for about 4 years. I've been baptized. And this May, I will be graduating, praise the Lord, from Altoona Bible Institute.
Amen.
What God has in store for me, I have no idea. Now, I'm not going to be bragging or anything here, but being in the Reformed Unanimous ministry, I've now completed my third book for the second time. What I'm going to do after I finish all four books again, God will lay you something on me to do. I'm also, whenever the women's leader's not there, I am second in control. And let me tell you, it's humbling. I couldn't understand why God let me do what I do, but now I understand. It's now that there's other ladies that come out of that jail who don't understand God, don't even know who God is. And I can say, yes, I have walked in that steps. I have been in that orange uniform. I know what it's like, and I praise God for that. At first I didn't, but now I do. I also, one day a week, volunteer at the Altoona Rescue Mission thrift store. I also help with kindergarten, Sunday school, either Sunday mornings or Sunday evenings, and I also help in nursery. You know, and I just have to praise God and thank you. Now, am I a perfect Christian? No, not even hardly. Do I pretend to be perfect? I really don't. No. Do I have struggles? Yes, I do have struggles. But my struggles aren't like before. My struggles today are being obedient to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Remember always to look for the joy in rejoicing in any particular circumstance. To be long-suffering by having patience toward the shortcomings of others. Showing love without the thought of anything in return. Having meekness when talking to others without causing any kind of friction. To make sure I spend time alone with the Lord. And these days, I'm just so thankful for the Word of God and knowing that He sees and hears me and He is with me. There are many verses that I really fall on, but my two verses are about Him and going to Him are Psalms 18:2. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler, the horn of my salvation, and my high tower. And this one, I've just recently found it, and I fell in love with it. It's Isaiah 41:10. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. And I just praise God for His righteousness and His mercy. Now, in closing, I just got to say, you know, I pray that I've encouraged and I've blessed you because I'm truly blessed by being here. And whenever you see that drug addict or that drunkard or that struggling Christian that has maybe been backslidden or maybe hasn't come to church for some reason, reach out to them because it's of God's grace and mercy you are where you are today. They don't need or want a hand out, but what they really need is a hand stretched out and them lifted up. And I praise God and I thank you.
That's awesome. What a testimony. That, my friend, is the power of the cross. Wonderful to be saved, isn't it, Misty? It's just wonderful to be saved. Don't you like when a new believer, a young Christian, says, I found this verse? Just tickles you on the inside. Speak to you this Good Friday from Luke's Gospel in chapter number 23. It's hard to have a bad Friday, isn't it? It's Friday, right? Are all good. Luke's Gospel in chapter number 23, and it is verse number 23 through verse number 26 that we will read. If you have your copy of God's good and great book, out of respect for it, would you stand with me, please? We will read in unison, if you're able to stand. We will read in unison Luke 23, verse 23 through 26. Are you ready? Let's read. And they were instant with loud voices, requiring that he might be crucified. And the voices of them and of the chief priests prevailed. And Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they required.
And he released unto them that for sedition and murder was cast into prison, whom they had desired, but he delivered Jesus to their will. And as they led him away, they laid hold upon one Simon, a Cyrenian, coming out of the country, and on him they laid the cross, that he might bear it after Jesus.
Let's have a prayer together. Father, I'm grateful for the book that is in my hand. I'm grateful for it, God, this morning, because grateful for it this day, because it says in it, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. My Father, I would not believe this morning for a moment what Mr. Farrakhan said, that God does not love this world. I believe what John says this morning, God, that you so love this world. I don't believe what Mr. Farrakhan said this morning, that Jesus didn't die for the world, that God did not have a son, and God does not love this world. I believe this morning, God, that you love. Your love has no beginning and no ending, and that your love is personal. Glad that I have this book this day, my Lord. It is a lamp to my feet. It is a light to my path. Most of all, it tells us about thy great love for the poor, the fallen, the least, the last, and the lowly. Father, may our eyes be turned to Jesus on the cross this day. But may we, like he, look beyond the cross, despise the shame, say hallelujah. Sunday come. Bless these that hear. In Jesus' name, amen. Yea, God. Luke chapter 23 tells us this. They, in the 23rd verse, they were instant with loud voices. Now, it doesn't necessarily indicate that those that were crying, crucify. The good book does not necessarily indicate that those that were crying, crucify, were the largest crowd. But it does indicate that they were the loudest crowd. It does indicate that they were the most fervent. That's the idea behind the word instant. That they were the loudest and they were the most fervent and they were the most demonstrative. Because of that, they got their way. I do not believe this day that we could find any scriptural evidence, no evidence in this book that I hold in my hand this morning, that the same people that shouted crucify him earlier were shouting Hosanna. I don't believe the Hosanna people were the crucified people. I believe they were two separate and different crowds. There's no evidence that the crowd that shouted crucify him, that was so fervent and so passionate and boiling and bubbling in their rage against Jesus, that they were the largest crowd, but they certainly had the biggest mouths. Let us remember in society and remember this Good Friday that it's the squeaky hinge that gets the oil. I would urge you this morning, I would urge you this day, Lord, help me to forget it's that it's not in the morning. If I say that one more time, I'm just going to pack it in and go eat some grapes in the room back there. And cheese and crackers. I know what it is. I'm nervous. I mean, we're on InstaChat and SnapFace and Twitter and all kind of social media. Squeaky hinge gets the oil, my friend. Let's remember that. To remember that, my friend. To remember that in the ballot box. To remember that in the course of society. Lift your voice for God, my friend. Lift your voice for Christ and for his cause. It is sad but true that the majority seems to be silent. You could not convince me this day, this Good Friday, that the majority of our country is for infanticide or for abortion. But I would say it appears, in my opinion, that that crowd has some awfully big mouths this day. It is the squeaky hinge that gets the oil, it seems. Crucify him with instant voices. Crucify him with loud voices. So loud that they were drowning out the voices of the Hosanna crowd. Would you lift your voice this day, this Good Friday, for the cause of God and the cause of Jesus Christ, for the cause of life, for the cause of righteousness? Speak up, my friend. Speak up. Lift your voice. The pilots of this world are giving ear. Notice what it says in that passage. He, verse 25 says, delivered Jesus to their will. And verse 24 records, Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they required. That their loud voices and their screeching, hollering, crucify him, caused the court to be swayed in that direction. Somebody on this Good Friday, speak up for God. Lift your voice. Cry out and speak up and say, right is right and wrong is wrong and truth is truth and error is error. It could sway the court of public opinion, my friend. It could turn souls to God. It could spare lives. You and I dare not be silent this day. And Pilate gave in to their demands. Pilate was not a brave man. Pilate was a wicked man. But he was swayed by those loud voices. And Jesus is led away to be crucified. But notice in the passage, in verse number 26, and as they led him away like a felon, and as they led him away like a lamb to the slaughter, and as they led the perfect Son of God away to a death most ignoble and most like a felon would die, one Simon comes out of the country. Simon, the Cyrenian, comes out of the country. And on him, they laid the cross. Cross was a heavy thing, my friend. Cross was a weighty thing. It was a powerful thing. The cross humiliated you. The cross executed you. The cross executed you in a fashion that was like no other. It was a brutal death. We know that because this good book that I hold in my hands this day says that Jesus humbled himself. The book of Philippians records that he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Most awful death in that time that a person could experience. The cross was a powerfully brutal thing, my friend. And they came and they find this one Simon and they lay the cross upon him. I want you, if you would, to turn to the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 15. And it would be in Mark's Gospel and chapter number 15 and verse number 21. Would you read this verse with me, please? Mark's Gospel, chapter 15 and verse number 21. Did you find it? Are you ready? Are you set? Let's read.
And they compelled one Simon, a Cyrenian, who passed by, coming out of the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to bear his cross.
What was done with the cross of Jesus, this powerful, heavy, humiliating, brutal thing placed on Simon, it says in that verse, the good book says, and they compel. It's a word of force. It's a word of duty. It's a word of conscription. It was no pleasant event. They went and they grabbed Simon out of the crowd by force. Perhaps the Roman soldiers tapped him on his shoulder with their spears, and they said, at spear point, they said, you, sir, carry this cross. I would say this day that the cross is a heavy and brutal and awful thing that leads to death. That's the power of it. But as Misty testified, and as I can testify today, it not only is a brutal thing, but in that same cross is the power to bless. Simon was not only humiliated, but Simon was honored by that compulsion that was laid upon him, by that most horrendous of events. He just happened to be passing that way. He just happened to be going near the place where Jesus was going to be executed. He just happened to be going that direction. His sons would have been there. Imagine the humiliation and the shock and the awe when those soldiers stop him at spear point and tap him. Imagine what his boys thought when they said, our dad has to carry a cross. Imagine the shame and the humiliation. I wonder what those boys did when that happened. But that's the power of the cross this day. You know it, don't you? The power to humiliate, the power to humble, the power to put to death, and the power to bless. That cross was placed on Simon, laid on Simon. Did Simon carry that cross all the way? Take your Bible and turn to the Gospel of John and chapter number 19, John's Gospel, and we will see how far it was that Simon carried that cross. The Gospel of John chapter 19, and it is verse number 17. The Gospel of John chapter 19 and verse number 17. Simon was compelled. He was commanded to carry that cross. He had no choice in the matter. He was humbled. It was a brutal thing that he was carrying. He was trailing behind a felon. He was suddenly thrust into this awful event and experience. Do you know this day? Do you understand? I'm sure that you do. That life can take you places that you thought you'd never end up. And you say, how did I get here? I wonder if Simon didn't say, how in the world did I end up here carrying the cross of this felon? This awful crowd and the wailing and the, how you've been there. And you say, how did I end up with this cancer diagnosis? How did I end up with this divorce? How did I end up with these fines? How did I get here? But I suggest to you this day that it was not by accident. It was by the providence of Almighty God. That even when it doesn't seem like it, God's hand's steering you. Even when it seems like it's just happenstance, it's not happenstance. The whole lot is cast into the lap, but it's disposed by the hand of a good God today. How long did Simon carry that cross? John's Gospel, chapter 19, in verse number 17. Would you read this verse with me, please? Gospel of John, chapter 19, verse 17. Are you ready? Are you set? Let us read. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew, Golgotha. It would seem that that passage indicates he bearing his cross. Verse 17, in my opinion, could that pronoun he could refer to Simon. That Simon carried his cross. the whole way to that place of execution. Simon carried that cross because he was commanded, and by compulsion, he carried that cross the whole way until there was no further to carry it. It's what I urge you to do this morning, this day, my friend. I urge you this day, carry your cross until the finish line. Carry the cross of Christ until the last breath. Carry the cross of Christ until the day is done. Carry it till one day there is no more cross. Hallelujah. Carry it to the finish. So Simon carried it until he was at that place of execution. You see, the power of the cross is that once you pick it up, you never ever stop carrying it, ever. It's always on your back. It's powerful. It's permanent. You're never relieved of it until death discharges you. But bless God, one day the battle's going to be over. And bless God, I believe this day, the heavier the cross, brighter the crown. The heavier the cross, the brighter the crown. Is your cross heavy this day? I would say to you, carry it to the finish and look forward to that crown of life. But don't put it down until the race is over. Even if you got a limp with finish your race with a limp, carry that cross. The heavier the cross, the brighter the crown. Don't ever stop carrying it till you're discharged. What if it was an ignoble thing for Simon to carry that cross? He finished it. What if it was a humiliating thing, and in that day and time it would have been for Simon to carry the cross? What if it was incredibly embarrassing for his sons to see their dad behind this felon carrying that cross, going somewhere that they never ever expected to have happen? Here's what I'd say this day. Carry the cross to the finish. Carry the cross and never ever put it down until it's your discharge. I ran about a year ago a half marathon. You run a half marathon the same way that you run a 5K, the same way that you run a mile, the same way that you run 5 yards, a step at a time. Somewhere around mile number 7, I'd never been hurt before running, but somewhere around mile number 7, my legs started hurting. Well, I was going to finish. Somewhere around mile number 8, I thought my leg was going to fall off, but I was going to finish. I thought I was going to be the only one-legged preacher in Altoona if I lived through that half marathon. But I was going to finish. The whole way to Golgotha, Simon carries that cross. The whole way to Golgotha, Simon endures that shame and that awful spectacle. The whole way to Golgotha, he carries it to that place of execution. Carry it till your finish line, my friend. I started walking about mile number 8, somewhere around in there, and I'd run a little bit and walk a little bit and run a little bit and walk a little bit, but I was going to finish. I finished second to last in that race, but I finished. Are you tired this day? Does the cross seem heavy this day? Just carry it one more step. Discharge papers gonna come one day. I remember with joy when I went across that line and said, at least I wasn't last. I went across that line and there was a lady standing there with a medal. It wasn't really metal, it was plastic. And she took it and she put it around my neck. I felt like I was the only Olympic champion ever out of Altoona, Pennsylvania. I felt like I was Manute Bol and Spud Webb and any racer that you could name all together, and Sid Crosby and Mario Lemieux and Will Stargell and Roberto Clemente all wrapped in one as they had taken that plastic medal and draped it around my neck. Simon carried it to the place of finish. You carry your cross, my friend. Carry his cross, my friend. Wait till you see that crown of life. What a day that will be. Carry it till you're discharged. That's the power of the cross. It's permanent. It wasn't just some rough pieces of board. This cross became a message. Romans chapter 1, verse number 16 says it is the power of God unto salvation. Behold the power of the cross. It's the power of God that saves sinners. I think this day that it is a sad and awful thing that the cathedral of Notre Dame burnt down. But I'm not sure how many converts they recorded there this year. I'm certain that they had beautiful stained glass. I'm certain that they had amazing ornamental architecture. But I'm not certain how many converts were won to Christ in that cathedral. Can I tell you this, my friend? Sinners are saved by the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The cross is not just wood and boards. The cross is a message. Hallelujah for that message, because it's a divine message that this day. Behold the power of the cross. The power of the cross to save the least and to save the lonely. Behold the power of that cross and the power of that message. Miss Castile told about it. I could give you my testimony about what the cross has done for me. I grew up in church. When I was a little fella, we always went to a Good Friday prayer breakfast. It was an ecumenical one, and it was the church that I grew up in was a Presbyterian church, but a lot of the Presbyterian and Protestant churches in that area gathered together. And see, my father had died from cancer, and there was another man in the Presbyterian church, Robert Kennedy, and his wife Bernie, who loved us. And every Good Friday, Mr. Kennedy would take, and he would take my brother Scott and I to that Good Friday prayer breakfast. And preacher, he always took, and we always sat at the table where the speakers were with all the other pastors. Amazes me that God would do that. And I'd sit there and I'd think and look at these men as they ate and listen to them talk, and I just sat there and thought, these men are the best men that I've ever been around. Well, I have the cufflinks on that Mr. Kennedy and his wife Bernie gave to me. This day, he's long since been departed this life. But I grew up going to church and religious. But you understand this morning, it's not religion that saves. You can get baptized in every Baptist church in Blair County, my friend, and religion won't save you. Jesus saves. Call his name Jesus, he'll save his people. He shall save his people from their sins. Well, there was this girl when I was a senior in high school. Her name will be protected to defend the innocent. And we were on a flag football team together. And this was back in the day when boys were boys and girls were girls, and you didn't wonder which one was which. You either an X chromosome or Y chromosome today, my friend. That's just science. That's all right. One and one still two. Truth is truth. Well, we were on the same flag football team, and boy, could that girl catch a spiral pass. I said to her, I'd sure like to come to your house and meet you and come visit you. And she said, that'll be fine, and told me where she lived. I hopped on my 10-speed bike. It was before kids had cars in high school. Lord Jesus. Now you got shoes that cost as much as my first car cost. But I hopped on that green Schwinn 10-speed, had a headlight for safety, and a taillight for safety, and a rearview mirror. Quite a ride. I had that thing all tricked out. Pulled up into her driveway, put the kickstand down, walked up to the front door. Jesse Teal met me at the front door. And Jesse Teal, when she opened the door, Mrs. Teal said, "Oh man, I gave that girl's last name away." Yeah, I did that this morning is when I asked. She came to the front door and she said, "I think you're no good." She was right. Mums know stuff. Amen. Mums read your mail. Snail mail, email, Gmail, your snap face and all of it. Mums in all of it. She said, "I think you're no good." It's the power of the cross, my friend, to change that. She said, "I think you're no good." She said, "I think you're on drugs." She was right. She said, "You ain't coming around my daughter." I said, "Oh, Lord Jesus, this went south in a hurry." Nothing against you if you're from below the Mason-Dixon line, but that sure went south in a hurry. She said, "The only way you're going to come around me is this. The only way you come around my daughter is this. You come sit by her in church." I said, "Well, I can do that." She said, "Well, we got church this Wednesday night." I thought, "Well, that's odd. I've never been to church on a Wednesday night, but if I get to sit by Teresa, it's good." Oh, now you people on Twitter going to go search her out and find her. Sat for the first time in a gospel preaching service. Heard not just about a piece of wood and beams and rusty nails. I heard a divine message. Pricked my heart. I rejected it. Pastor gave an invitation. He said, "Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here today and you're not sure that you're saved, raise your hand." Well, I'm a stubborn Scotch-Irish boy. I didn't bow my head, close my eyes. I look around. Everybody around putting their hands up except me. I said, "That preacher picking on me. I'm the only new person here. He got a pick on me." But I kept coming back. I kept coming back. And I kept coming back. Finally, Miss Castile, I hit bottom. All right to hit bottom, my friend. Ain't nowhere to go but up. All right to be just flat out broke and busted and without anything. That's where God finds you, my friend. Finally, I hit bottom. Said, "I don't know anything about this book, but I do know this. I'm tired of the dope and I can use some hope. I don't know anything about this book. I don't know John 3:16. I don't know anything about this book. But see, when my dad died in sixth grade, Pastor Richard Morley, a Presbyterian minister, opened this book. And he read 2 Timothy chapter 4. He said, "I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith." Sitting there in my bedroom that night, and I said, "I think I can find that verse in that book." And I found it. And I read it, and I said, "That's good. Wouldn't mind having some more of that." I started reading all of 2 Timothy chapter 4, and started at the top of the chapter. It says, "I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus, preach the word." For something happened down inside my heart and soul and spirit that day. I said, "There's something in this world I'm made to do." It's the power of the cross, my friend. Went to my youth pastor that next Saturday morning and I said to my youth pastor, I need to be saved. That's why I'm a free man tonight, this day. I'm a free person today because of the power of the cross. The power of the cross today is that it sets captive people free. The marks and the miscast steals free from sin. Can I tell you, if you're bound up and if you're in a mess this day, there is a God and there is a Christ that is not just crucified, but He alive today, still in the liberating business. That's the power of the cross, and He can set you loose and get you free. Behold the power of the cross. Was it an honor or dishonor for Simon to carry that cross? I submit to you it was both. Don't you know the world this day thinks we're crazy? Sure they do. There's all sorts of other things out there. Why are you in church? Why are you doing? There's all sorts of other things. Why are you in church on a Friday? Do you understand there's money to be made? There's places to, there are homes to buy. There are businesses to build. There's entertainment. There's pleasure. And here we sit with a book. But there's also honor in the cross, my friend. That I would say out of the possibly thousands of people that were along that pathway as Jesus was being led to His death, we know three names. Simon, Rufus, and Alexander. Now be honest. If your dad and your mom name you Rufus, all right? Come on now. Bob, okay. Pete, sure. Gary, Mark, I mean, easy words, I mean, easy names. Rufus, really? You see him when he in kindergarten? Steve, here. Paul, here. Rufus. 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 We know three names. Simon, Alexander, and Rufus. Imagine the horror and the fear as they see their dad grabbed from that crowd and thrust into this event. And perhaps their little boys just tagging along as this maddened mob is streaming toward the place of execution. Doesn't your heart go out for those boys? I would say today that there's power in the cross to bless the young people of this community. And the same Christ whose cross blessed Rufus and Alexander can bless you this day, my young friend. It changed my heart. It can change your heart, young person. Yes, it can. Remember a couple years ago, there were some young children that they came to our church. A knock came on the door and we went to the door and there stood one of the young kids and I believe it was a social worker also. And the little girl was in tears. The social worker said their parents have been arrested. We're hoping they can stay with you. We did our best, but because we already have four kids, the possibility of adding three more, the state and the county had rules prohibiting that. So into the system they went. My heart breaks for that. My heart just breaks for that. My heart breaks for the kids that are out there in our community today, running the streets. Here's what the answer is, my friend. It's this book and the message of this cross in my hand here. That it's this book and this message of this cross that has power to bless the Rufuses. Rufus, Alexander, it has power to bless them. Young person, don't believe the lie of this day that the world has all the fun and all the happiness. There's blessing in this message of the cross. Blessing, there's a blessing in it, I say. Remember a couple weeks ago, we have a Wednesday night program. Usually about 10 kids or so will come to it. And a boy from the neighborhood walked in and he was sitting in there, and we led that boy to Christ that Wednesday night. That's just fun. Well, we had a revival meeting, and so as a result, we didn't have services the following Wednesday. But the following Wednesday, Cody was taking the garbage out. And Cody came back in and said, "Dad, there's someone sitting on the porch." I said, "Well, son, do I owe him money? Do I not owe him money?" "No," I said, "who is it?" And he said, "It's that boy." Went out, and there he was. We had to tell him, "Sorry, there's no church tonight. But you come back next time." Next time he showed up, he came back, brought two of his friends with him. Can I tell you, there's power in that cross and in the message of the gospel, power in it. But will you carry that gospel? Will you carry that cross? It's humiliating. It's heavy. It's awful. It's disgusting. You're mocked because of it. But here's what happens. Long time after Simon is laid in the tomb and his life is over, you can read in the book of Romans, I believe his name is recorded in Romans chapter 16, where he is noted among one of Paul's associates. See, because Dad picked up that cross. The son picked up that cross. You have no idea who you're carrying the cross for this day. I urge you to carry it, because it blesses. It's awful and hideous, and it's executing, and it's horrendous, but it blesses the next generation, my friend. Carry that cross. Tell them God loves you and I love you. Tell them John 3:16. Carry it, my friend. There's a blessing in it. It's the power of the cross. Let's bow our heads and we'll have a prayer. Heavenly Father, I'm grateful to have this day a heart that's changed and friends around me that say likewise. And friends around us that have the same experience and the same faith. Lord, bless Brother Gary, bless Pastor Gary and the church here. Use them to turn many to Jesus Christ in this big, bad, beautiful railroad city. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the cross. Cursed and blessed all in one thing. That can only be your cross. It's really the only cross we know anything about. Bless Pastor Gary in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Mann, for the power of the cross. And on that cross was my Savior and your Savior. Hallelujah, what a Savior he is. Number 133 in our hymn books. Let us stand and sing this out. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Whenever we come to that part, sing, Hallelujah, what a Savior. Let's stand and sing it out.
Lead us, O Christ, our King, for the Son.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, good afternoon. Seriously, that's the best you guys have? All right, we're going to change that here in a second. So I have time to do one more song for you guys, and thank you so much for having me here this afternoon. What an honor to be with you guys and hear such awesome messages. My style of music is a little bit different than what I've played for you guys so far this morning. I love the old hymns, I really do, and I'm not going to stray away from the old hymns for this last song, but definitely stray away from a little bit of a stylistic difference, if you would. About a mile from our house, I guess I'll introduce it this way, but about a mile from our house, there's a business, and they have a really tall flagpole, and I love going by there and seeing our American flag fly, you know, on a half cloudy day and a little bit of a breeze. I mean, it's gorgeous. It's absolutely gorgeous. But you look at that flag, and what that flag represents, it's brutal. It's brutal what that flag represents and what we have had to do to get what that flag represents. We have freedoms in this country that the rest of this world wishes they have. You know, you wouldn't be able to be here right now in a lot of different countries. That is awesome. That is awesome. That cross, it's an awful, peaceful-looking thing up there, hanging there, isn't it? And a lot of people come to the foot of the cross to feel peace. But what that cross represents is brutal. Absolutely brutal for freedom that you can get absolutely nowhere else. Today, in this 3-hour period, you know, we think about what Christ went through for me. That's how I'm looking at this whole time. What Christ went through in these 3 hours for me. That is awesome. That is awesome. But that cross represents the freedom that we have not to be able to walk wherever we want, but the freedom that we have in things we don't even realize yet. Eternity. We think we understand what eternity is. We have no clue. We think we understand what heaven is. We have no clue. The freedoms that we have because of what Christ did on that cross are freedoms that we have no idea. We can try to imagine what they are, but we have no idea. We are here in these 3 hours thinking about what Christ went through. But the awesome thing is that we have victory. Amen. We have victory because of what Christ went through. Amen? Amen. We have victory in Jesus.
Amen. All right, we're going to do this song, do it the right way. How about everyone up in your feet, put your hands down.
That's just how I play my trumpet, which I have in my study. Good place to keep it after that. He's just getting warmed up. Thank you, Chiz Ryder. By the way, there are some CDs back there in the back of the annex. He'll be back there after the service, if indeed you would like to talk to him about those. Well, turn in your copy of God's Word to the Gospel of John, chapter 19. John, the 19th chapter, and I want to read verses 28 down through verse 30. John chapter 19, verses 28 through 30. And again, invite you to stand out of respect for God and His Word as I read and you follow along. John chapter 19, verses 28 through 30, where the Word of God says, "After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the Scripture might be fulfilled, saith, I thirst. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put upon hyssop and put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost." It's interesting that those three words, "it is finished," are one word in the Greek, which means paid in full. And what Jesus Christ was saying at that particular point, the entire work of redemption is complete. We want to talk about the prospect of the cross. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the victory that's in Jesus, and we ought to rejoice over it. We thank you for what we have in Christ. We thank you for the cross. And now as we consider for a few minutes the prospect of the cross, teach us those things you'd have us to know for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. According to Revelation chapter 13 and verse 8, the work of the Lamb of God, who is Jesus Christ on the cross, was a planned event by Almighty God from eternity past that no one, even all the forces of Satan, could have stopped. In addition, had Christ not given himself to go to the cross, all of Satan's power, all of the Jewish leaders, and all of the Roman soldiers combined could not have driven one nail through Christ's hands to hang him on that cruel cross. I'm here to remind us all today that the cross of Christ was in the plan of God, and it was completed just as God planned it to be fulfilled. Everything God had in mind regarding the cross came into fruition when Jesus uttered those words, "It is finished, paid in full." Nothing, absolutely nothing more needs to be done to make our redemption complete. With that in mind, we ask the question, what is the prospect of the cross? In other words, what has successfully come into fruition through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross? What do we have? What do we see? Because of the cross of Jesus Christ. That makes this Good Friday. You think of somebody dying on the cross, that's not good. But the outcome is tremendously good, and that's the prospect that we are focusing on for a few minutes here this afternoon. Or this morning, or tonight, or we've been in all three zones this afternoon. First of all, let's look at the prospect of the cross from God's perspective. And there are numerous things that I could mention, but just allow me to mention three. Number one, all of the prophecies concerning Christ's suffering were fulfilled exactly as they were given. Do you realize that there were over 100 prophecies concerning the cross given in the Old Testament? Over 100. And you look at Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53, as we have printed in our bulletin this afternoon, you can see that Jesus Christ went through a tremendous time on that cross, beaten beyond recognition, beaten in shame. That was all prophesied. And it was fulfilled. On that cross, all of God's requirements for the full atonement of sin were made. The Bible teaches us in Leviticus chapter 17 that the blood was given for the atonement of the soul. The blood in the Old Testament in those bulls and goats and lambs simply covered over the sin. But Jesus Christ, the Bible teaches us in Hebrews chapter 9, when He died, He is our atonement that has taken away all of our sin because of the cross. Not just covered over our sin, but took it away, all because of the cross. From God's perspective, all of the redemptive work of God is complete on the cross. Through the cross, the full price of sin was paid. Romans 3:23 says we've all sinned and have come short to the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, His Son. And I stand before you today rejoicing with you that in the blood of Jesus Christ, all of our sin has been covered. Amen. That's the prospect of the cross from God's perspective. It was fulfilled just as He intended it, just as He planned it, just as He directed it. But what about from our perspective? What is the prospect of the cross? What has successfully come into fruition through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross? Now let's turn over to Romans chapter 5 for just a minute. Romans, the 5th chapter, is a great chapter in that great book that teaches us great doctrine about who God is and what God has done for us and what God's going to yet do for the Jewish people. But in Romans chapter 5, we see that from the perspective of the lost and the unsaved, through the cross of Christ, there is hope. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 says, "But God commendeth," that is, demonstrated, "His love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Jesus didn't die for anybody who was saved. He died so the people could be saved. While we were yet in our sin, while we were yet going away from God, while we were yet totally depraved through imputed sin, Jesus died on that cross. Back in the Old Testament, Jeremiah 31 and verse 3, God says, "I loved you with an everlasting love." That love was proven when Jesus went to the cross and died and said, "It is finished." The love of God was manifested. Jesus died so that we can trust Him as our Savior and have life eternal and life abundant. Do you have it? Have you received Christ? Is Jesus your Savior? Are you born again? From the perspective of the lost, Jesus died that the lost might come to Christ and be born again. But you see, from the perspective of the believer, there are many things in Romans chapter 8 that we can anticipate as the result of the cross. For instance, go back to verse 1, where it teaches us that those of us who are believers have peace with God through the cross. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1 says, "Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." You see, apart from Jesus Christ and apart from the cross, there is no peace with God. Every now and then you'll hear people say, or they used to say back in the old days more, "Make peace with God." We can't make peace with God. It's already been made through Christ on the cross. All we need to do is receive the Christ to the cross, and that peace with God is made. Then believers are justified by Christ's blood. Go down to verse 9 of Romans chapter 8. It says, "Much more than being now justified by His blood." Do you realize that those of us who are sinners, when we come to Jesus Christ as our Savior, it is God who declares us not guilty with respect to our sin? Oh, we're still guilty. We are guilty of sin. All have sinned and come short to the glory of God. But through the work of Jesus Christ on that cross, when we say, "Lord Jesus, I trust You to save me," God the Father, through the work of the blood of Jesus Christ, looks at us and says, "You're justified. I declare you not guilty with respect to your sin." That ought to have even caused Presbyterians to say hallelujah tonight. Thirdly, from the perspective of the believer in Christ, oh, we like this one. As believers, we are saved from God's wrath through the Lord Jesus and His work on the cross. Again, look at verse 9. It says, "Much more than being now justified by His blood." Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. We live in a day and age where people are saying, "Take the blood out of the hymn books. Take the blood out of the Bible. You take the blood of the way, there is no salvation." "Much more than being now justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him," through Christ. What is God's wrath? It's eternal separation from God in hell. People don't like to talk about that either. But sometimes you better talk about it, you better think about it, because if you don't trust Christ and His work on the cross, that's where you'll spend eternity. You say, "I don't believe in hell." Well, I could go down here to Middletown and stand in the middle of the railroad track and say, "There's no train coming," until it hits me and I face reality. The real point is that there is a hell. And the only way to be saved from God's wrath in hell, because we've rejected Christ, is to trust Christ. You say, "I never rejected Christ." Well, if you haven't trusted Him, you've rejected Him. But thank the Lord that for those of us who are believers, we are saved from God's eternal wrath through Christ's work on the cross. Then number 4, believers are reconciled to God through Christ. Look at verse 10 of Romans chapter 5. It says, "For if when we were enemies," and by the way, we are all the enemies of God apart from Christ. Pastor Tom Butler mentioned in the first hour that apart from Christ, we are the children of the devil. But through faith in Christ, we become the children of God. Why? Because we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. You see, the Bible teaches us that because of our sin, we are separated from God. We might be physically alive, but we are spiritually dead. The only way to be made spiritually alive is to trust Christ. And when we trust Christ the Savior, those of us who are enemies and alienated from God are united with Him, reconciled together to Him for all of eternity. Somebody needs to say praise God. All because of the cross. Number 5, believers in Christ are recipients of joy. The joy of God, the joy of Christ through the work of Christ on the cross. Look at verse 11. It says, "And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Joy is that which we have knowing that all is right with God. You see, happiness is based upon circumstances. If you came and gave me $1 million today, I'd be happy. I'm not expecting it, but that would make me happy. If I went outside and all 4 of my tires were flattened, I would not be happy. And I hope they're all in good shape. But whether I get $1 million or 4 flat tires, there's still joy knowing that all is right with God. And that's all because of the work of Christ on the cross. Then number 6, we learn from Romans chapter 8 that the perspective of the cross for believers is that believers have received all full atonement through Christ. You see that in verse 11 again, where it says, "And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have," when? Now, received the atonement, the at-one-ment with God through the blood of Jesus Christ. The at-one-ment with God through the blood of Jesus Christ. Praise God, when Jesus Christ died on His cross, wicked old cross, those of us who are wicked old sinners had the opportunity to become saved, born again, washed, made pure in Christ through the atonement that Jesus offered on that cross. Have you received that atonement? Now finally, as we look down to Romans chapter 5, we see the believers have eternal life through Christ. Look at verse 21. It says, that as sin reigned unto death, that's what sin does, it brings death, it brings separation from God in this life and eternal separation from God in eternity. But even so my grace, thank God for His amazing grace, even so my grace reigned through righteousness unto what? Eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. We are born in this world in sin. Sin has been placed to our account through Adam and Eve's sin there in the Garden of Eden. But Jesus Christ died to give life to all who call upon Him. And the ultimate prospect of the cross is that we can spend eternity with Jesus Christ in a land without tears and a time without end if we receive Christ. If we take the atonement, if we believe. And the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord might be saved. Shall be saved, delivered from sin through faith in Christ. Have you done that? We've been here for 3 hours talking about the glory of the cross. What is our response? What should our response be to the finished work of Jesus Christ on that cross? Number one, we should praise and thank God for what He's done for us through Christ on the cross. But then we should worship and serve God for what He's done for us through Christ on the cross. My challenge to you this afternoon as we come to the end of these 3 hours is that there is victory in Jesus. But here's the point. If you don't know Christ, receive Christ. Because it's because of the great work of Christ on the cross that we call this day, this night, this morning, whatever, Good Friday. It's what Jesus Christ did for us on that cross. Do you know Him? Have you been born again? If not, call upon the name of the Lord Jesus right now. Ask Him to save you, and He will. He turns.